Good evening. As we begin this time of celebration, we acknowledge the land upon which the Columbia University Irving Medical Center stands is ancestral unceded territory of the Lenape people. Let us respect their legacy. Congratulations, new physicians. Congratulations, new PhDs. You have stretched toward your dreams and grasped your hopes. We are grateful for all of the support and encouragement that your family and friends, sometimes entire communities, have provided you during your academic and professional journey. We give thanks for each of you for the quality of healthcare and the groundbreaking bench and clinical research that you will do to push the boundaries of new knowledge in medicine and in science. We are assured that your clinical skills are excellent, and your respect for humanism in medicine is strong and consistent. We are grateful that you are prepared to be the changing hands, faces, minds, and hearts of medicine. Do offer to all of us your skills, your integrity, your intuition, your diligence, and your best moral judgments. Be humbled by the high esteem that your patients, their families, and communities will assign to you. Be wise and humane, be just and generous, be compassionate, be brave, and be blessed. May it be so. May it be so.
Thank you, Chaplain Davis. Welcome, Dr. Maybank, distinguished faculty, MD and PhD graduates of the class of 2021, and welcome to your family and friends who have joined us today to celebrate your truly extraordinary achievements. We have altered our traditions to adjust to the continuing worldwide pandemic. The traditional celebrations of class day and graduation have been merged to celebrate your collective achievements. The Student Faculty Awards, normally featured at our in-person celebrations, are no less significant, and a complete list can be found in the programs provided. As you toast your graduation today with a small number of family and friends, safely physically distanced, please thank your family and friends for their support, but also take a moment to acknowledge your own tremendous accomplishments that these MD and PhD degrees represent. Whether it has been 4 years in medical school or even more years in pursuit of your graduate degree, you've spent a significant part of your early adult lives pursuing your dreams. To quote a great university leader, Columbia President Lee Bollinger, a Columbia education is transformative. He used the word when communicating about a new campaign to raise more resources to provide financial aid to Columbia students, to remove the barrier that might prevent students from accessing a Columbia education, indeed a transformative Columbia education. Most of you receiving MDs today have already benefited from the generosity of donors dedicated to reducing or eliminating student debt. In April 2018, we announced a scholarship program made possible by a magnanimous gift from Dr. Roy and Diana Vagelos. This sweeping scholarship program made VP&S the first medical school in the nation to replace student loans with scholarships for all students who qualify for financial aid. Most of you medical students were finishing your first year when we announced this program, but you may have benefited during your remaining years at VP&S. The new program replaced student loans with scholarships, and about 20% of our medical students with the greatest financial need received full tuition scholarships. The endowment created by the gift from Dr. and Mrs. Vagelos allows you to choose a medical specialty based on your passion and calling, not on income potential, that will help you pay back student loans. The program is transformative and will continue to be transformative for generations of students to come. All of you were at Columbia in 2017 when the College of Physicians and Surgeons was renamed the Roy and Diana Vagelos College of Physicians and Surgeons. And some of you, particularly those receiving PhDs today, were on campus in 2016 when Columbia University Medical Center became the Columbia University Irving Medical Center to honor the generosity of the late Florence and Herbert Irving. Though our names changed, our missions and values have only been strengthened through these new identifications. Our names are new, but our historical legacy will always be worth celebrating. One historical milestone appropriately worth mentioning today is the 100-year anniversary of the first women to receive MDs from Columbia. It is fitting, then, that the VP&S class of 2021 is nearly 53% women, and your class has been majority women since you entered in 2017. The six women who received MDs from Columbia in 1921 include Guli Lynn Muller, who is credited with persuading the medical school dean to admit women. Dr. Muller graduated first in her class, and two others among the six graduated in the top five of the class. The other five graduates of in 1921 were Susanna Hay, Emma Corwin, Dorothea Kernow, Elizabeth Wright, and Mae Mayers. They deserve our thanks for creating a path for so many others to follow. In closing, I want to commend both medical and PhD graduates on the patience, fortitude, and dedication you showed during the last 14 plus months as the pandemic affected every aspect of your education and your personal lives. In medical school, it affected your classroom experience, your clinical rotations, your social interactions, even your residency application process. For PhD students, the cutback in research more than a year ago likely interrupted your training as well. The lost experiences were significant, but I hope the successes each of you build during your long careers will more than make up for that. I encourage you to use your degree to show how transformative education, especially a Columbia education, can be. To present the class of 2021's distinguished teacher, I am pleased to introduce your class president, Ron Laraquente.
My name is Ronald Laraquente, and I'm the 2021 class president. And I have the honor of presenting our Teacher of the Year. Though we have many amazing educators throughout our time at VP&S, the class of 2021 has selected Dr. Rachel Gordon to be our Teacher of the Year. She's been teaching at VP&S for almost 14 years, and she is consistently recognized by students for her unique approach to education. Where some employ lengthy lectures, Dr. Gordon uses flipped classrooms and audience response systems. She makes infectious disease a topic notorious for dense memorization, dare I say, fun? Students describe Dr. Gordon as hilarious, hip, quirky, creative, and brilliant. They say that her positivity is infectious. But the thing that really stands out about Dr. Gordon is that she genuinely cares about the experience of the learner. Taking one of Dr. Gordon's classes gives a glimpse into the bright future of medical education. Without further ado, Dr. Gordon.
Welcome, VP&S class of 2021, parents, partners, family, friends, and fellow educators. Congratulations on graduation. You should all be so proud. It truly takes a village. And a big thank you to Boards and Beyond, Sketchy, and New World. We couldn't have done it without you. But kidding, not kidding aside, please take a moment. Take it in. You have finished medical school. You are physicians. This is a tremendous achievement. And congratulations to me, too. I am truly honored, though, and blessed by this award, and absolutely cherish this privilege addressing you today. Thank you. I have been fortunate enough to give the class day address before, and each time it was special, but for a slightly different reason. I am a medical educator, but also an infectious disease physician, an epidemiologist. But wow, here I am on Zoom speaking to you in the middle of a pandemic. there have been over 140 million cases of COVID-19 worldwide and more than 3 million deaths. And here we are after a year, no, years filled with so many egregious acts of hate. Breonna Taylor, George Floyd, Dante Wright, on and on, too many killings. This hate, that too is a disease we need to fight. This year is just different. We are lucky to be here. Too many of our fellow healthcare workers, citizens, friends, and family literally didn't make it. But we are here. And in order to give you some advice, I'm going to quote the legendary author and activist, Dr. Maya Angelou. Quote one, I've learned that I still have a lot to learn. With a career in medicine, you will always be learning. And thank goodness for that, because you all know you killed the mannequin at least 20 times. But that's okay. If you had the skills of Osler himself and board scores in the 100th percentile, would that be it? Would you stop there, the perfect doctor? The answer is no. There is no destination in this career, only a journey. COVID is part of this journey. We are facing the unknown. This is a tough example that we'll never know everything. So just keep learning and learning. And don't be too hard on yourselves in this marathon of a career with no finish line. Take comfort in quote number two. If you find it in your heart to care for somebody else, you will have succeeded. It can be that simple. You will care for people along the way. You've all actually succeeded already. Quote three, hate. It has caused a lot of problems in the world, but it has not solved one yet. You have been through a lot. The world has too much hate in it. You all impress me so much with the poise and the commitment and compassion you have made to justice and equity and inclusion. Please continue to lead the way to a better world. And while you address the big picture, remember that the little things matter too. Quote four is, my wish for you is to continue to be who you are, to astonish the world with your acts of kindness. Back in May, I was taking care of COVID patients and was clearly faltering, dehydrated from wearing the mask and the PPE all day. And a nurse, who I didn't know, brought me a glass of water because it looks like you need it. I don't remember a lot from that time, but I think I'm always going to remember that. It was just kind. I needed it. We need kindness because bad things are going to happen. In the world, on the wards, at the end of every day, it will be easy to think of all of the terrible things that went wrong, every mistake, every awful thing, what you could have done better. But I know you're also going to do a lot of good, and you're going to be kind too. So how about this? Make sure that each day you think of at least one thing that went right, something you did right. This is advice one of my mentees, who was an intern at the time, gave me that was about 15 years too late for me. So I'm giving it to you now. You're welcome. If you've been to my office, there's a quote up on the wall that's been there for years. If you're always trying to be normal, you will never know how amazing you can be. I seriously believe this because I've never been normal. I don't think I've tried. On the last day of my microbiology course in medical school, I literally wore a toga and a homemade placard that said, "The end is near," because it was the end of the year and I wanted to be an inspiration. Exhibit A, proof that you can come a long way in life. Okay, I don't know how amazing that was, although people stared with amazement. But think of so many amazing people who didn't stick to the status quo. The person I've been quoting this whole time, Dr. Maya Angelou, certainly didn't. She was so many firsts, a writer, a performer, an activist. She empowered women and people of color. She changed the world. Would Steve Jobs have revolutionized technology if he'd let, to paraphrase his words, the noise of others' opinions drown out his own inner voice? If researchers hadn't developed out-of-the-box mRNA nanoparticle technology, literally at the ready to deliver a SARS-CoV-2 vaccine, where would we be? Would there be a light at the end of the tunnel? maybe not. So forget about normal and aim for amazing. No biggie. I have this amazing opportunity to teach you, and that helps me to be the best version of myself. That's what I want for you, to be the best versions of yourselves. But remember, don't just blindly follow the script because, quote, you can only become truly accomplished at something you love. Class of 2021, you are ready for residency. You are ready for the future. Quote, determined to live life with flair and laughter. I do, and you should too. You will be great, and you will be unforgettable. Good luck and congratulations.
Thank you, Ron, and congratulations, Dr. Gordon. In place of the traditional class history, some of the graduates have shared some memories from their time at VP&S.
Hi, everyone. I can't believe it's been 4 years already, and for some of us longer. Today, we get to celebrate one of the last big milestones in our careers. I think of all the lectures that we've had on molecular mechanisms, genetics, our sometimes awkward encounters with our standardized patients. I think back to rounding on patients with our pockets full of instruments, medical handbooks, cheat sheets, walking around with our stethoscopes swinging from our necks, practicing our rehearsed questions. It's amazing to think about all of the hard work that we've put in to get to this point and how well prepared we are now for our futures. I'm really proud to have you all as classmates. I feel like I can truly say amazing things are happening here.
Congratulations, class of 2021. I'm so proud of us all for making it this far, and it's been an honor to serve as your president over these last few crazy years. Medical school is filled with ups and downs. One moment you're hand-delivering a baby into this new world, and another moment you're trapped and alone in a stairwell holding a bucket full of surgical supplies. But through it all, we stood together. We vented and we listened, we laughed and we cried, we supported each other and grew together. As we move on to become the most amazing physicians and surgeons, let's never forget where we came from. Let's never forget what it was like to be the small voice in the room. And let's vow to always try and uplift the voices around us. I want to wish you guys good luck and congratulations again.
This image has been on my wall for the past 4 years. As physicians, let's remember that we have a calling to bear witness. We are healers. Congratulations.
Congrats, class of 2021, with a special shout out to the Black and Latinx Student Organization. It's been such an honor to train alongside everyone, and I really do wish everyone the best. Reminder to always use translators. Reminder to always keep a happy smile. I wish you all the luck in all of your future careers.
We just wanted to say thank you, and we are so grateful to have been a part of the Columbia Bassett program, had such amazing mentors, and made lifelong friends. We truly wouldn't have made it through med school without our families, our amazing Columbia Bassett classmates, mentors, and Dr. Weil and Dr. Brennan's support. We cannot thank you enough.
What a crazy few years it's been, but I'm so grateful to have had such wonderful classmates through it all. I'm constantly amazed by how brilliant and talented and kind everyone is, and how surprisingly willing some faculty are to dress up as Game of Thrones characters when asked. It's been an honor to serve as your class vice president, and I can't wait to see what the future holds for all of us. Congratulations, everyone.
Welcome to Columbia VP&S graduation game of Never Have I Ever. Never have I ever watched an entire block of PhD lectures online immediately prior to taking the exam. Never have I ever worn a bold outfit choice to the boat cruise. Never have I ever walked past the no food and drink sign with an iced coffee while entering VEC 201. Never have I ever forgotten a standardized patient's name mid-OSCE. Never have I ever gone to the New York Pride Parade and showed up to the hospital with residual glitter. Never have I ever gone straight to brunch after a morning shelf exam. Never have I ever been sad medical school is ending but so excited for everyone's future success.
Congrats, everyone! Congratulations, everyone, class of 2021. I am so proud of all of you guys. I am so happy to have met you guys and gotten to know you over the past 4 years. I cannot wait to see what you guys accomplish. You guys are gonna do amazing things. And I'm so happy that I can refer my patients easily to a pediatrician, a cardiologist, a neurologist, a psychiatrist, anything, and know that my patients are gonna be taken care of.
Congratulations, class of 2021. I wanted to share with you guys one of my favorite quotes by Maya Angelou. She said, "People will forget what you said, people will forget what you did, but people will never forget how you made them feel." I may not always remember the alveolar gas equation right off the top of my head or the specific genetic causes of primary ciliary dyskinesia, but I'm always gonna remember all of you. My peers, my colleagues, my teachers, my friends, and our patients are always going to remember us, not because we explained their health condition to them so well, but because we showed them care when we were trying to help them, when we will try to help them. And it's been a pleasure to learn with all of you, and it will be a pleasure to serve with all of you.
Hi, my name is Teddy Goetz, and I'm going to be reading a poem that I wrote during the major clinical year entitled White Coat Noise. Med school breaks you, they warned me. A small notebook in my pocket like Mary Oliver, I too walk in fields. Fluorescence lighting the hospital hall serves proxy for the waking sun outside, washing out my skin. I pretend it has the same effect on the beeping monitors because wonder peeks out from stillness, and I desperately seek even ephemeral pause. Learning to save lives, I can't help but query, who gets to help people live them? Should I have picked that job instead? I don't need an accidental needle stick to show my bleeding heart. Med school breaks you, they warned me. And I finished their sentence, open, and words fall out. Thank you, and congrats, everyone.
Congratulations, everyone. I'm so excited to be graduating with you all today. The last 4 years have been so full of so many great moments together, and I'm really thankful to you all for all of those moments. But when I think back on some of the things that really stand out about the last 4 years, I can't imagine this time without CHAMP. And I just want to give a special shout out to all of the CHAMPers that are graduating today and say thank you for making medical school what it was. I am so glad to have that time every single week that we had in preclinical and pre-pandemic at clinic, and then after clinic getting together and having a ton of pasta at Pastici or going to Gin Ramen and just getting to unwind and be together. So thank you so much for those times. I will always remember them.
Oh, yeah.
As everyone knows, medical school can be really difficult at times, and I have a lot of people to kind of that have really helped me get through that. But I also have a lot of really good memories, and I think my favorite set of good memories probably comes from the group of people that I had dinner with every Sunday night. It grew out of just a couple of times starting in MCY, wanting to get together with friends that I missed, and from there on, we started having dinner every Sunday night through MCY and through fourth year, virtually during the pandemic. And without this group of other med students, I don't know how I would have gotten through all those times. It was incredible to have a group to both debrief the medicine with and laugh with, and then, you know, commiserate with when things were hard. And it was also amazing to watch them grow into the doctors that we've all become. So I really appreciate that group, but of course everyone else who helped me get to this point. Congratulations to all of you. I'm really impressed with everything everyone's done, especially during the pandemic, and I can't wait to see what all of you do. I hope I get to consult you down the road.
Hello everyone, and congratulations. I am so excited to be graduating with you all and cannot wait to see all the wonderful things that you all do. I honestly have loved the past 4 years despite the challenges and the difficulties. I will forever cherish all the wonderful memories we created, from our first year living in the dorms to our preclinical years to the times in the hospital and then surviving a pandemic together. I cannot wait again to see you in reunions, and congratulations. Best of luck to all of you.
Can you say con?
No.
Grats?
No.
Doctors?
Da-da.
Hooray!
Hooray.
Congratulations, doctors. Yay!
Congratulations, class of 2021. You've all worked so hard to get to this moment. I'm really proud and really humbled to have spent the last 4 years getting to know each and every one of you. I've been so inspired and amazed by all of you, and I can't wait to see what you accomplished over the next steps in your journey. And I can't wait to celebrate with you at our reunion, which hopefully will be in person, indoors, and maskless.
Congratulations, class of 2021. We finally did it. And to all the friends and family watching, always remember that old saying, an apple a day keeps the doctor away, but only if you aim it well enough.
Class of 2021, congratulations. Go forth into the world, and remember, always see your patients.
It is now my pleasure to introduce this evening's speaker, Dr. Althea Maybank. Dr. Maybank is a Senior Vice President and Chief Health Equity Officer for the American Medical Association, where she directs the AMA Center for Health Equity. Dr. Maybank went to undergraduate school at Johns Hopkins University and earned her MD from Temple University School of Medicine. She also received an MPH degree from our own Mailman School of Public Health. Trained as a pediatrician, she spent time as a hospitalist here at NYP's Morgan Stanley Children's Hospital and at St. Luke's University Health Network. In 2006, Dr. Maybank became the founding director of the Office of Minority Affairs in the Suffolk County Department of Health Services. She later joined the Brooklyn District Public Health Office within the New York City Department of Health and Mental Hygiene as medical director and assistant commissioner. Using a place-based approach, she created templates for community-driven learning and implementation to improve built environment improvements, such as bike lanes to encourage active transportation. She continued in other roles within the city's health department, including being founding director of the Center for Health Equity, where the Race to Justice initiative was launched to transform the culture and public health practices and embed health equity in all of the health department's work. This work has been recognized and used as a model by other New York City agencies, the CDC, and World Health Organization. Neighborhood efforts under her inspirational leadership were strengthened through enhanced coordination in violence prevention, teen pregnancy prevention, birth equity, and faith-based initiatives. In 2019, Dr. Maybank joined the AMA as the inaugural Chief Health Equity Officer. She hosts a weekly Zoom discussion called Prioritizing Equity, where physicians and other healthcare leaders focus on root causes of racial disparities in medicine. She helped organize an appeal for government to track the impact of COVID on communities of color. Dr. Maybank has been a medical contributor and writing for Ebony, Huffington Post, and Arise News. She's taught medical and public health students on topics related to health inequities, public health leadership, physician management, physician advocacy, and community health organizing. We are so honored, truly honored, to have you address graduates of the Vagelos College of Physicians and Surgeons, Class of 2021, and their guests. Welcome, Dr. Maybank.
Hello, graduates, and all of the family members, loved ones, and friends who are sharing this moment with you. As a Columbia Mailman alumna who spent a lot of time on the Medical Center campus, it is my absolute honor to be here to congratulate you on behalf of the American Medical Association's Center for Health Equity. Also with the help of Dr. Devlin and Ms. Jella Thorne, in jogging my memory, I'm especially honored to be able to bookend your time here as a medical student. I don't know if you remember, but I remember I had the privilege to be one of your guest lecturers in your Foundations of Clinical Medicine course within the first month when I was Deputy Commissioner of the New York City Department of Health. Just awesome. Firstly, although I'm not with you in person, I want to acknowledge the original homelands of the Lenape people that Columbia University occupies. We are all living off ancestral lands of indigenous peoples, and let's celebrate the resilience and strength that all indigenous people have shown in this country and worldwide. So you've made it. And you made it through one of the toughest moments in recent history on our planet and in healthcare. Moments that tested all of humanity's bodies, hearts, and spirits, literally, especially those of healthcare professionals such as yourselves. You know, to be a physician is a tremendous privilege, not afforded to many. The privilege to enter people's lives who are absolute strangers, in which they hand over their keys to vulnerability, and trust that you are going to always do the best that you can do to promote their health and well-being. When I finished medical school, a new millennium had started, it just began. And Dr. David Satcher was the 16th Surgeon General at the time. And I remember him well as he launched the United States Department of Health and Human Services roadmap to a nation's better health. It was entitled Healthy People 2010. And I heard this idea of eliminating disparities for the first time. About a year after medical school finished for me, we had a deadly major disaster that entered this country and in New York City more specifically. September 11th, 2001, also known as 9/11, forever altered how we viewed the world, and it changed our way of life, much in the way that COVID-19 has and will continue doing so. David Satcher's vision of eliminating health inequities didn't happen in 2010, and COVID-19, our newest public health crisis, and racism, our always existing and present public health crisis, reminds us that injustices that impact the health of people and communities are entrenched and are a result of generations of policies that structure discrimination into the very systems that are to make us whole, such as housing and transportation, education, employment, and most importantly to many of us, our healthcare system. And so over the coming months and years, the United States medical system will struggle to adapt to new post-pandemic norms. This new day calls upon all of you to know and understand what creates health more broadly, beyond the halls and walls of the healthcare system, the hospitals and doctors' offices, and understand how larger political, historical, structural, social, and cultural context in which we all live impact our patients' health, your health, and the health of your loved ones. You must now gain an individual and institutional understanding of social justice and how to operationalize it in service of the health and social well-being of communities. It requires us, as Brian Stevenson says, to get proximate to the people who are suffering, which means we must prioritize and integrate the voices and ideas of people and communities experiencing great injustice and who have been historically excluded, exploited, and deprived of needed resources to thrive, whether they are communities of color, women, people with disabilities, people with low wealth, people who identify as LGBTQ+, and those in rural and urban communities alike. The new day pushes new physicians to develop a critical consciousness that seeks truth and acknowledges the historical harms that powerful organizations both intentionally and unintentionally made invisible, including my own, of the American Medical Association. Very few medical institutions in this country are immune from pasts in which their mission didn't include everyone, and the truth that it claimed to teach often excluded people, as well as pioneer and elevated science to justify a hierarchy of human value, especially that based on skin color. You know, right down the street from the medical school at the corner of 103rd and 5th in Central Park, across from the New York Academy of Medicine, once stood a statue that is now rightfully removed of Dr. J. Marion Sims. He was considered the father of gynecology, and well known and well documented by his own account, he performed vaginal procedures in the mid-1800s on enslaved women without anesthesia to perfect medical interventions and innovations we still use to this day. Later in his career, Dr. Sims was lauded by the American Medical Association and elected president in 1875, a past that we still need to reckon with. Today, you become graduates of a powerful and long-standing university with a history that stretches back to before the formal founding of the United States, and known for its great accomplishments, activism, and the production of influential leaders. You also become graduates of the first institution in the country to confer a Doctor of Medicine degree that has always been recognized to be at the forefront of medical teaching, with a mission since its early days to, quote, teach the truth about medicine in order to promote the good of mankind, end quote. Something absolutely to be proud of. And it is prudent to know and remember that it too is an institution that has a history with needs to examine, publicly challenge, and reckon with the past institutional values and actions that may have produced inequity and harm, work that I am clear has begun. With this complex legacy comes great responsibility, opportunity, and privilege for both the institution and for you as soon-to-be physician leaders. The responsibility to listen, act, and be accountable to helpful narratives, not harmful ones, that allow you to fully see and understand the real and complete truths of your patients' lives and the complete truths of institutions you will work for. The opportunity to lead courageously, to speak your truth, and to always be and do better with genuine and loving humility. And the privilege to use this new power that you will have to recognize, name, and change injustice and shape a more just society. Many of you and your colleagues will question, why is this my work and my responsibility? Isabel Wilkerson shared in her new groundbreaking book and work, Cast the Origins of Our Discontents, many people may rightly say, I had nothing to do with how this all started. I have nothing to do with the sins of the past. My ancestors never attacked indigenous people, never owned slaves. And yes, not one of us was here when this house was built. Our immediate ancestors may have had nothing to do with it, but here we are, the current occupants of property with stress cracks and bowed walls and fissures built into the foundation. We are the heirs to whatever is right or wrong with it. We did not erect the uneven pillars or joists, but they are ours to deal with now. So whether in OBGYN, pediatrics, surgery, dermatology, radiology, any specialty, asking and answering critical questions, such as how do we ensure our efforts, tools, and systems do not discriminate, exacerbate inequities, or deny care? How can we disrupt the beliefs and actions that undermine equity? What are the kinds of alliances, infrastructure, and systems change that are necessary? All of these provide meaningful direction to learn different truths and expose what has been made invisible, and add a sense of humanity to the existing scientific evidence base. I truly believe you will need to embrace joining medical care and public health in ways that facilitate system building that aligns the two fields instead of segregating them. You will have the opportunity to reimagine, to dismantle, decolonize, redesign, and reconstruct the healthcare and public health system through a vision that reclaims a broader understanding of health. A vision that centers health, racial, and social justice, humanizes yourselves, and affirms human rights and embraces joy. Our bold and necessary path forward seeks to pivot from ambivalence to urgent action. from euphemisms to explicit conversations about power, racism, gender, and class oppression, forms of discrimination and exclusion. From passive to specific action, supported by resource distribution and redistribution and infrastructure change. From rationalization and good intentions to comprehensive analysis of structures and systems, policies and practices leading to real change and impact. And from lack of accountability to an active embrace of equity and justice as a core mission and strategy. You must remember, we are all born equal, and health is our human right. And health is political. And the United States' response to the COVID-19 pandemic has highlighted for the need for medicine to have an explicit political voice. Doing so means that we are going to have to expand our public voice and partner with folks in media, federal, state, and local government, public health, and in underserved communities consistently and systematically neglected. This begins with the recognizing and upholding these communities as experts of their own health, following their lead, building alliances, and sharing power. Ultimately, you are going to have to choose how you are going to show up as physicians, with grace and understanding that your choice will evolve over time. You're going to have to find out what gives you purpose behind a piece of paper and the letters MD after your name, and answer questions such as, what is going to give me hope to persevere and push through moments when I'm tired and exhausted? As many of you and your colleagues have been over the past year and a half. And how do we inspire power held by a few to be and to do differently beyond their own self-interests and own experiences, and to really care? I fight injustice in healthcare, as many of you know. And so what gives me hope is the realization that I am part of a legacy of fighters and healers and door openers who also wanted to be free and liberated and enjoy the opportunity and have the conditions, the resources, and power to achieve optimal health. I feel a strong sense of obligation and responsibility to that legacy that has allowed me to be here and speak with you today. As I mentioned, you will evolve. I am evolving as a physician and how I'm choosing to show up. My advocacy skills have sharpened and quickened on behalf of patients, physicians, my teams, and myself. My voice is more powerful, clear, and strategic in finding ways to move souls and hearts to deeply care, to seek, to truly understand. David Satcher has more recently expressed, we need leaders who care enough, who know enough, who will do enough, and who are persistent enough in this effort. And I say in addition, I say less of leaders who feel the need to intellectualize harm experienced by many communities. I truly look forward to the leadership of your class and generation. Many of you are already leading and using your voices to advocate for change, social justice, and a better America and a better health system. And I encourage you to continue doing so and to encourage your physician colleagues to do the same. The world in many ways is looking to healthcare and its community to lead. As Grace Lee Boggs shared in The Seeds of Change, these are the times to grow our souls. Each of us is called upon to embrace the conviction that despite the powers and principalities bent on commodifying all of our human relationships, we have the power within us to create the world anew. So congratulations, and I hope you find some fun ways to enjoy this COVID time celebration. Wishing you the best in life, and congratulations again, and take care.
Thank you, Dr. Maybank. To recognize our PhD graduates, I'm pleased to introduce Dr. Arthur Palmer III, Associate Dean for Graduate Affairs.
I join Dean Ruske in welcoming graduates, families, and friends on this momentous day in the career of a scientist. The student community of the Roy and Diana Vagelos College of Physicians and Surgeons includes over 350 PhD and MD-PhD candidates within the coordinated doctoral programs in biomedical sciences. These young scientists work in laboratories on the Irving Medical Center, Morningside, and Manhattanville campuses, and contribute importantly to the scientific and therapeutic advances of Columbia's research enterprise. I would like to thank Associate Dean Dr. Yinghui Mao and the Directors of Graduate Studies of our departments and programs for their assistance throughout the year in running of the graduate program. They do the real work, while I have the honor of presenting the graduates today. More than 50 students earned their PhD in the past year, despite the difficulty posed by the COVID-19 pandemic. Indeed, many of our students have contributed importantly to the unprecedented worldwide scientific effort to understand and ultimately control the SARS-CoV-2 virus. To reach this day, all of these graduating doctoral students have made significant scientific discoveries during the course of their thesis research and have skillfully defended their dissertations before examination committees of leading scientists in their fields. The directors of graduate studies nominate the most outstanding of these students for special recognition. Selecting the best from among this group is a challenge. I am reminded that our students are remarkable and their accomplishments are astonishing. I thank the distinguished faculty committee that assisted me in this difficult task. We recognize two students with the Dean's Award for Excellence in Research, Thomas Blazajewski and Barbara Stokes. Dr. Blazajewski is a PhD student in the Integrated Program in Cellular, Molecular, and Biomedical Studies. He conducted doctoral research in the laboratory of Professor Horace Wang of the Department of Systems Biology. Dr. Blazajewski's research focused on the translation of recent advances in machine learning towards new applications in synthetic biology. Dr. Stokes is a PhD student in the Department of Microbiology. She performed her research in the laboratory of Professor David Fiddock. Dr. Stokes' research characterized the basis for artemisinin resistance in the Plasmodium falciparum malaria parasite. We also recognize two recipients of the Titus M. Cohen Prize for Excellence in Research in Basic Cell and Molecular Biology, Julian Berger and Hannah Mendez-Levitin. Dr. Berger is a PhD student in the Department of Microbiology. His research with Professor and Chair Gerard Carcenti demonstrated that osteocalcin is a stress hormone and unraveled the molecular and cellular mechanisms underlying its function. Dr. Levitin is a PhD student in the Integrated Program in the Department of Systems Biology. Her research, conducted in the laboratory of Associate Professor Peter Sims, discovered an intermediate state that occurs during activation of T cells and may represent a novel regulatory checkpoint in the adaptive immune response. Finally, we recognize two recipients of the Titus M. Cohen Prize for Excellence in Research in Translational Biology, Bohao Liu and Zhaobing Wang. Dr. Liu is an MD-PhD student in the Integrated Program and conducted research in the laboratory of University Professor Gordana Vunjak-Novakovic. Dr. Liu studied extracellular vesicles secreted by human-induced pluripotent stem cell-derived cardiomyocytes as potential therapeutics in heart disease. Dr. Wang is a PhD student in pathobiology in the laboratory of Associate Professor Shan Jia. Dr. Wang's research focused on the role of DNA and resection factors during normal lymphocyte development and oncogenic chromosomal translocations. Due to the nature of scientific research, PhD thesis defenses take place throughout the year, after which these newly minted scientists move on to new opportunities around the world. Consequently, I am delighted that so many of this year's graduates are with us today. We are proud of all of the doctoral students who graduated this year. I am pleased to present now those graduates who chose to participate in today's ceremony. K. Catherine E. Birkenbach. Catherine E. Brain. Sylvia Cho. Elizabeth Ha. Tian Kang. Marcos Lanio. Naja Marshall. Elliot Mitchell. Sierra N. Singh.
Thank you, Dr. Palmer, and congratulations, graduates. To award the MD diplomas, I'm pleased to introduce the interim co-vice deans for educations, Dr. Jonathan Emil and Lisa Melman.
It is my great pleasure to welcome you. This is a class of exceptionally caring, engaged, and resilient students dedicated to helping others, determined to making a difference in the lives of their patients, in healthcare, in addressing healthcare disparities, and deeply committed to equity. From the outset, they have been inspirational in their commitment to serving the community, to innovating new programs, to collaborating with peers, faculty, and other healthcare professionals. While excelling in a challenging curriculum, the 2021 class simultaneously initiated new academic and extracurricular programs. They founded the First Generation Low Income Partnership for Students. They founded the Companionship Project for Hospitalized Patients Without Support. They expanded the Behavioral Health Service in Cosmo student-run clinic, and they made the service available to patients in the other student-run clinics. They co-led revisions to the Student Honor Code and its procedures. They revived the Big SIBS program, and they collaborated in interprofessional programming with the other health science schools. Then, as the pandemic took hold of New York City and our healthcare system and community, our graduates demonstrated incredible resilience and creativity, turning an enforced clinical pause into an opportunity to contribute meaningfully across CUIMC, NYP, and New York City. This class was instrumental in partnering with us to develop and lead a COVID-19 student service corps that now has thousands of student participants who have volunteered in scores of areas, from telehealth hotlines and remote patient monitoring to procuring PPE for frontline workers to teaching youth in remote learning. It is a model for other schools domestically and internationally. And lastly, the commitment of today's graduates to anti-racism and to equity and justice, along with their unwavering advocacy for addressing healthcare disparities, has served as a catalyst for our school for change and change in the medical center. We are so very proud of and grateful to this class for their partnership and leadership. So let me tell you more about the class. We have 156 graduates, including 10 from the Columbia Bassett program. In terms of dual degrees, we have 12 MD-PhD students, 6 MD-MPH, 5 MD-MS in biomedical sciences, 1 MD-MS in biomedical engineering, 2 MD-DDS, 4 MD-MBA, 3 in the 3-year PhD to MD program, and 26 more who completed an extra year of research, resulting in 38% who took extra time for research or a dual degree. And speaking of duals, we have 6 couples who matched from the class, 2 of them in-house couples. 12 students went abroad for first-year summer experiences before the pandemic curtailed global travel. 22% matched at Columbia for part or all of their postgraduate training. 40% will remain in New York, mostly in New York City. And lest you think these students only study, 9 babies were born during medical school, including twins, as well as 2 siblings. 15 students got married, and 9 more are engaged, including an in-house couple. Students completed an Ironman half triathlon, competed running a 4-minute 55-second mile, wrote a novel, published their poetry, danced with a Broadway national tour, and many got a dog. All of this alongside the epic feat we call medical school. Graduating from VP&S is a remarkable milestone worthy of tremendous celebration. We are especially proud of this class for their achievement in the most challenging of times. Each student has worked extremely hard to reach this day, and we are confident they have what it takes to be outstanding physicians in residency and beyond. We send you, the class of 2021, and your loved ones our most heartfelt congratulations. Be well and do good.
So the big question of the moment is, are we really becoming doctors today? The short answer to the question is absolutely. What a spectacular moment for each and every one of you, brand new doctors. We are so wonderfully proud of you on this momentous and special day. But there is a slightly longer answer to the question. The one I want to capture briefly here is that though today is the day you officially become doctors, you've been becoming doctors for a very long time. You started becoming doctors when you were little kids. You wondered how the body works, and you realized that people need one another to make it in this world. You became more of a doctor when you asked yourself, do I want to do this, and can I? Your growth as a doctor continued when, if you were lucky, the people around you encouraged and supported you, or at least got out of the way. And if you were less fortunate, when you really fought for it. You took a big step towards this day when you applied to VP&S and allowed us to meet you. You took an even bigger step towards this day when you accepted our offer of admission and allowed us the privilege of training you. The last few years of your life and ours have been a series of smaller but no less important steps. Developing a broad and deep fund of medical knowledge, building skills you will use for a lifetime of caring for others, navigating humbling experience after humbling experience, growing, sparking your passion for inquiry and scholarship, choosing a specialty and your next professional home, supporting health in our communities through your service and equity and justice through your advocacy. Today you become a doctor, but you have been becoming doctors for your whole lives. For us, it has been an honor to teach you and to befriend you. Your bond to VP&S is for life. We are so, so very proud of you. Congratulations.
Claire Azen. Philip Allen. Taiwo Alonge. Chloe Alchek. David Alvarez Cespedes. Fiona Angel. Isao Ansai.
Lucas Axiotakis. Elizabeth Ballo. Marco Barber Grassi. Luke Barker. Chelsea Batista. David Bender. Jack Berger. Emma Berube. Sonia Besagar. Cassidy Nicole Bethancourt. Kelly Blanche. Darius Boardbar. Rebecca Braheny. Andrea Brown. Alex Butler. Miriam Callahan. Joanna Kappa. Anna Choppy. Corey Chang. Estefania Chavez. Andrew Chen. Anna Chen. Leonard Chu. James Choi. Shang Chao. Rita Chumdurm-Padetsuk. Zoe Cohen. Kirsten Craddock. Christian Dialli. Christopher Dialli. Ryan Dinsa. Claire Donnelly. Fikaya Falodun. Enzo Fainton Yusta. Lauren Fields. Grace Finkel. Diana Flanagan. Elise Frazier. Jeremy Frederick. Karen Gambina. Vineeth Gungram. Anastasia Gasgalis. Teddy Getz. Yosef Gopher. Kathleen Goodwin. Stephanie Granada. Taiwei Gua. Stephen Halepas. Sophia Hamidi. Bradley Hamor. Brianna Hickey. Patrick Ho. Narek Israelian. Elizabeth Ito. Taylor Jacob. Ayana Jacobs. Samuel Jacobson. Pooja Jairam. Karan Johnny. Kai Jones. Anastasia Khan. Austin Katie. Alexis Kasotis. Saveli Kelibayev. Margaret Kelly Goss. Apurva Kadagi. Haman Kim. Amy Labar. Kendrick Lang. Ronald Laraquente. Heather Lee.
Ori Lieberman. Chanel Ligon. Cesar Lopez. Chien Ma. Barbara Maggid. Wilson Mai. Haiti Malave. John McGovern. Andrew Malahi. Da Meng. Benjamin Meyer. Omid Modiri. Christine Moon. Christopher Mukasa. Ellen Myers. Mary Natacom. Catherine Nicholas. Maya Nishikawa. Ama Natoso. Fiema Wigwe. Reed O'Connor. Walter Oliver. Daniel Paul. Catherine Parker. Robert Perry. Samantha Parsons. Victoria Perez. Eduardo Perez Torres. Paul Kirk Reardon. Anne Reed Weston. Charles Rygard. Vicky Rowe. Shalif Robbins Juarez. Shireen Sadri. Alfonso Salsinas. Andrew Sanchez. Allison Saunders. Miko Sayer. Jackson Scharf. Eric Schwepp. Angelina Seffens. Rahul Sharma. Max Shen. Mary Shimkus. Alexander Sisti. Quinn Solfisberg. Sarah Suhu. Isabel St. Clair. Gabrielle Steinel. Lauren Suarez. Andrew Sudler. Brendan Sullivan. Eric Sun. Sean Sun. Betsy Sito. Phyllis Thangaraj. Kelston Thomas. Emily Thompson. Jameer Thompson. Andrew Thornton. Jonah Tischler. Megan Traeger. Corey Trowbridge. Christopher Troy. Luke Sang. Christopher Valentini. Teresita Velez. Elizabeth Wang. Linda Wang. Yu Wong. Kirsten Ward. Laurel Whitney. Aaron Williams. Peter Wu. Ling Feng Yi. Lillian Zurihun. Jack Jong. James Zhou.
Next, I invite you to join me in reciting the Hippocratic Oath as we first did together at your white coat ceremony several years ago. This Hippocratic Oath is over 2,000 years old
and has been handed down through centuries of physicians. We recognize that while it is tradition to incorporate this formal oath into our ceremonies, it is certainly imperfect in 2021. Please join me. In our profession, it is a custom established more than 2,000 years ago that no one may be admitted to its honors who has not first expressly undertaken its obligations.
I do solemnly swear.
I do solemnly swear.
By whatever
each of us holds most sacred,
that I will be loyal
to the profession of medicine
and just
and generous to its members.
That I will lead my life
and practice my art
in uprightness
and honor.
That into whatsoever house I shall enter,
it shall be for
the good of the sick,
to the utmost of my power,
my holding myself
far aloof from wrong.
From corruption, from the tempting
of others to vice,
that I will exercise my art
solely for the cure of my patients,
and will give no drug,
and I will give no drug,
perform no operation
for a criminal purpose,
even if solicited,
far less suggested,
that whatsoever I shall see
or hear of the lives of my patients,
which is not fitting to be spoken, I will keep inviolably secret.
I will keep inviolably secret
these things.
I do swear.
Let each of us
bow the head in sign of acquiescence.
And now, if I will be true to this,
my oath.
May good repute ever be mine.
The opposite.
If I shall prove myself.
Forsworn.
Physicians, we give thanks for each of you. Go with compassion and courage. Hold sacred your commitment to lifelong learning in your vocation, profession, and in your life. Care for us. Care for us all. Godspeed.
Thank you, Chaplain Davis. This concludes our virtual ceremony. Congratulations again to all of you, graduates, families, and friends alike.